May I start?
Yeah, you can.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. Myself, Dr. Henna. I welcome you all on behalf of IHMA Kerala State Chapter. IHMA Kerala State Chapter has conducted a series of 50 sessions of the Season 1 free webinar, and this is the Season 2 of free webinar conducted by IHMA Kerala State Chapter. And before starting the session, we should salute our master, Dr. Samuel Hahnemann, because without him, we are nothing today. And thank you so much, master. And dear delegates, only the permitted recording salon will be uploaded in the YouTube, because some recordings consist of information of patient, which cannot be disclosed in the internet. So I request all the delegates to make fruitful use of all webinars. And before going to the session, I would like to thank Asha Homeopathic Academy, which is based in Indore. They conduct short and long-term courses for homeopathic students and practitioners. The mission of the academy is to provide professional education to the doctors with practical utility to make them skilled homeopaths. Their mission is to create intellectual stimulating anyone who join with them. And for more details, please go through their website and I will be given it in chat box. Today's the speaker is Dr. Yamini with the topic Lack Remedies and Lack Remedies and their Indication. And I would like to introduce the speaker for today. Dr. Yamini is practicing since 2008 at Asha Homeo Health Center, Indore. She has learned under many like Dr. Rajan Shankar, Dr. Sarkar, Dr. Jayesh Shah, etc. She integrates many tools and techniques into her practice needed to individual cases. She is a holistic health enthusiast who has an immense interest in treating pediatric and psychiatric cases too. She handles Asha Homeopathic Academy along where she teaches regularly about the advanced methodologies to young budding homeopaths. She has also won the prestigious Lipi Award, solved the case conduct from Bhamra Arogya Trust in 2014. She has started many offline and online homeopathic courses for students which can help in learning application of homeopathic principles. She believes that learning is a never-ending process and one can learn best by sharing the knowledge one has. And I am with all enthusiasm. Hello?
Yes, yes, Dr. Henna. Can I talk?
Can you hear me? Okay.
Before starting the session, I have to say something.
One minute. Okay. With all enthusiasm in the name of all, I welcome Dr. Yamini Ramesh to the session HOP Season 2 to share her knowledge on understanding lack remedies and this indication. Before that, I would like to welcome Dr. Deepu, IHMA coordinator, to deliver a few words about the topic.
Thank you, Dr. Henna. So, good afternoon, everyone. We have an amazing faculty today because since the day we started our HOPE, this Asha Homeopathic Academy and Dr. Vaibhav Jain, who is the husband of Dr. Yamini, did amazing work for us actually. I don't have words to tell more thing about it because it was such an amazing job they had done. They have, through their pages, they are promoting. I think if you are going to look for IHMA in Instagram, you will be seeing the Asha Homeopathy Academy. Like that, they are sharing our posters. So we are thanking you. We are expressing our sincere gratitude to you, Dr. Vaibhav Jain and Dr. Yamini, for their sincere effort in bringing this homeopathy in the heights. And I hope more people will inspire from you and the doctors who are not at all familiar with them, please subscribe them in YouTube. Or they also having done much webinars in their YouTube as well as in their Instagram group, the Homeopathic Junction. So on behalf of IHMA Kerala, we express our sincere gratitude to you, ma'am, and Dr. Vaibhav Jain. You can start the session. Okay. Hello, Dr. Amini, are you,
yes,
can you hear me?
Yes, yes, okay.
Yeah.
So just give me a second. Thank you so much for your kind words and introduction. You have spoken a lot about us. Thank you so much. From behalf of Dr. Weber, Homeopathy Junction and Asha Homeopathic Academy, I thank you. And thank you so much, Dr. Hina, for the nice introduction. Thanks a lot. So my voice is low,
little bit low.
Okay, is it better now?
You can increase the system sound, that would be better.
It is 100%.
Okay, then there then I will do one thing. I will turn off your video. Okay,
yeah,
I think it will be the range problem.
Okay, so I will turn off my video then.
Okay.
Hello.
You can. Can you do without the mic, without the headphone? Can you do it?
Without the headphone. Just a second. I'll try. Hello. Am I audible?
Yeah, you're audible, but the voice is very low.
Still low? Or
little
better?
Bit. I think in headset. Dr. Henna, are you hearing it? Hello, Dr. Henna.
Yeah. Hello, I'm here.
The voice is low or not?
Yeah, little bit worse. The voice is low.
Voice is low. So, okay, so I will increase my volume because the system's volume is 100%.
okay, fine.
Okay, yeah. And if still you people can't hear, let me
between
so that I can...
It's audible. It's okay.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. So my screen, is it visible?
Yeah, it is visible.
Yes.
Wonderful. Welcome everyone. And today we are going to talk about the lakh remedies. So this is one of my favorite topic to talk about because lakh remedies are immensely helpful in day-to-day practice. And since I got to know about the kingdom differentiations and I started studying about mammals and the group remedies, actually the group study, it has really helped me in solving my cases. So today I'm going to talk about the mammal themes, how to identify the lakh remedies, and also about few remedies which are very, very helpful in the practice. Because there are n number of lakh remedies which are available, many remedies, almost 55 or 56 which are well proved or nicely proved, I would say. And some lesser known remedies are also there. But we will talk about the major ones which are very useful, and also you can incorporate them in your practice. So you have attended so many IHMA webinars and other webinars also. So I hope you all know about how to differentiate between the kingdoms and how to identify the kingdoms. So I'm just talking a little bit about how to identify animal kingdom, because that's the most basic thing which we should know, and then only, you know, we can go ahead. So whenever you are just a second. So still my voice is very low.
It could have been better if it is little more high. Could have been better. It's audible, but still.
Okay. Little louder. Okay. I will try to talk little louder. Okay. So we should know whenever we are deciding a remedy or a group, we should know that whether really this particular case belongs to the kingdom from which we want to give the remedy. Otherwise it would go really wrong. So we can't really, you know, directly go to the particular remedy without knowing the kingdom or without knowing the family or sub kingdom or something like that. So first animal group we need to decide if we want to prescribe the mammal remedy. So Yeah. So whenever you are deciding a case, animal group kingdom things I want to tell you. So first is, we all know that the animals are very, very competitive in nature. Okay. So they are very competitive. They are very jealous. And we have to see the deeper pattern, which is beneath the case, which is beneath the story. So whenever a patient comes to you, he would tell you the chief complaints, obviously. But along with the chief complaint, if you probe well, if you go a little bit inside the story, he would tell you the whole life situation and the story. And that life story or the situation which he is suffering from, or the chief complaint which he is suffering from, will have one pattern. And that pattern is a deep pattern of a patient. So even if he is talking about a life situation, you should know that the life situation also comes from a deeper perception of the life, or a deeper perception of that person about the life. So I am just saying that, you know, initially what we used to do when we when I learned sensation cases, I try to go, you know, very deep into case, and I used to feel that whatever story he is telling is not at all important, and I need to get a sensation or a basic underlying pattern which will lead me to a sensation. Of course, that is true, that was true, but then, you know, after practicing for few years, I got to know that even the situation around a person, or the things which he is facing in his life or dealing in his life, also comes from his deeper pattern. So the story is also important, and to reach to a deeper pattern, only story can help you. So story also becomes very important. Earlier I used to, you know,
can you just plug off the headset and just reconnect it? I think the problem is with the connection, and even sometimes it is breaking. So can you do like that once more?
So what should I do? I should disconnect my headset and then again I join.
Yeah.
Okay. Hello?
Hello.
Yeah. Is it better now?
It's actually the same. okay. No problem. You can put the mic close to your mouth. Okay, no problem.
Okay. Just a minute.
It's audible. With headset, it is audible. If you can increase a bit, it will be better. That is what I'm telling. And the screen share is off now.
Okay. Yeah, I'm starting a screen share. I just stopped it to understand what is happening.
It is clear, very clear. The body is clear, actually. Okay, you can continue. Okay, so I request all delegates to use the headphone, okay? Okay, you can start. Okay.
So earlier I used to, you know, just forget the story, or just try to go into a experience of the situation. Of course, that is important, but along with that, the story also becomes important, or whatever he is telling you about the situation also becomes very, very important, because that overwhelming situation or stressful situation which patient is talking about, that will give you the essence of the remedy or the kingdom, and that really, really helps. So I have looked at the deeper pattern arrives in the overwhelming situation or stressful situation. So when we are dealing with such cases where we are, you know, thinking about the group or a kingdom, then we need to go to a stressful situation and ask him the experience of that situation. But here I want to make one note, a clear thing, which is, stress does not necessarily have a negative connotation. So this I have learned from my teachers and mentors, that stress does not mean only a negative situation in which you get stressed or, you know, tensed. So it doesn't have negative connotation. Instead, we can say that as a new or different situation, which can be either very, very positive or negative. It can be both ways. That can add, aid us, actually, it should be aid us in finding the remedy. So stressful situation, to get to know that whether this is animal kingdom or not, we need to know that. Animal language, you will see that the when the patient uses a lot of comparison in his narrative, when he is telling you the story, he is constantly compares himself or his disease with something or someone. So he is, if he's saying, you know, this psoriasis, this psoriatic patch is just, you know, creating my life hell, or making my life hell, and this is the problem, and these people are doing this to me, or my boss is like this, my mother-in-law is like this, and because of my mother-in-law, my life has become hell, or something like that. This type of language where there is constant comparison of things, then this is a clear indication or a very strong indication for animal kingdom. So if he is very, very competitive in everything, and he is comparing himself with others or the possessions others have, then it can be a animal kingdom case. Then he can say, you know, he might give you some examples like, I want to be different from others, I am better and more special, he is inferior, he doesn't have that thing, I have this thing, like this, all these things. So constant comparison, competitiveness, jealousy are very important themes of animal kingdom. Then, you know, you can have these type of examples that where patient says, I'm superior, he is inferior. He talks about big and small, important or not important, comparison. So comparison is often in the form of strength or vulnerability. So, you know, I am this much stronger and he is this much weaker. Or I am very weak, I cannot defend myself. And they are very, very strong. They are exploiting me. They are doing this to me. They are harassing me. This type of language gives you a clue that your patient might belong to an animal kingdom, or he needs an animal remedy. So the most important thing is to understand in animal patients that their problem is always outside. So when you are differentiating between amongst other kingdoms, like the two major kingdoms, mineral and plant, so it's not like mineral kingdom. Basically, mineral kingdom's problem is always inside. So their problem is that, you know, I have this problem, I lack in this area, or they would always talk about their inadequacies or their adequacies. Okay, so they would talk about, you know, whether I have this power to do, or this ability to do or not, and whether the other one has the, though they are comparing, but they are comparing the ability or the strength or the thing which they have. Okay, but in animal, the problem is always outside. So the problem is not that, you know, I don't have this ability to deal with this situation. The problem is these people are not allowing me to do something, or these people are not helping me or harassing me in living my life. This is a problem. So animal's problem is always outside, mineral problem is always inside. That is how you can differentiate. Then the basic feeling of animal individuals is that of being affected from the outside, and the outside may not be necessarily a person. So this is also a basic thing which you need to understand, that when you are deciding an animal kingdom, it's not necessary that the person is talking about his mother-in-law or his boss or her nephew or wife or, you know, someone. It can be a problem, a thing, a situation, a person, of course, or a disease. So a disease also becomes one thing with which the person might feel a problem. It could be anything. It could be, you know, something, some person, some force of nature, some disease or anything. Like, I have taken this example that one of my patients, he used to say, you know, this knee pain just harasses me like anything, and it doesn't allow me to do anything. My whole problem is this knee pain. And that is my problem, that please cure this knee pain. I just feel like, you know, just removing my knee. And I gave him a lac remedy only. So this type of narrative you will get. Another patient of mine, he told me that this throat pain or this cough he had, you know, he used to have this tonsillitis, sore throat, cold cough kind of thing. And he used to tell me that it doesn't let me speak at all, doctor. And because of this cold and cough, you know, I am living this type of life. Then another example, because of this psoriatic patch, my life has become hell, you know, like I told you. So I have taken few of these examples where I have prescribed animal remedies and where the problem was not a person, but a disease or something. So they would talk about strong or weak, you know, strength. Strength is very, very important for animals because then only they can survive. So we have heard this phrase, survival of the fittest. So only a fitter one can survive. So they need to see how strong or how weak they are and how they would deal with the life-threatening situations where their survival is at the stake. The issue of feeling a lot of strength or of feeling weak is very dominant finding in the animal kingdom. Animal kingdom language of strength and weakness, they can also talk about victim, being victim, or you know, they would talk about theme of this, there is a strong theme of humiliation or being insulted, injustice, and they can also talk about fairness, you know, that doctor, this is not fair, lack humanum, especially the strongest and the most intelligent mammal on earth, that is human being, us. So we always, you know, talk about that this injustice is happening, this is not fair with others, like this. So this fairness and unfair is also a strong theme of animal kingdom, and they feel either they are being victim of the situation and life, or they feel that other is suffering. So both ways you can see. So being victim or victimized is a strong theme. Sexuality, like I said, sexuality and jealousy. So it is not only expressed in, only sexual things, but it is expressed in body language more than in words. So they're liking for, you know, fluorescent colors, strong color themes, or the colors which can help them hiding in the environment. You know, the camouflage, what we say. So they have this good dressing sense, or sometimes very loud dressing sense, and everything related to sexuality is related to attraction, actually. So either they want to attract people or they don't want to attract people, both ways. But in human expression, you will see that they want to attract people. Then competitiveness. So competitiveness goes hand in hand with comparison. So the language of competition indicates the animal remedy. Aggression and anger are also the issue of, you know, space, needing one space is also very important for animals. Okay, so this is about, you know, animal kingdom. So whenever we have few of these traits, when the person is jealous, competitive, compares, highly sexual, he is talking about strength and weakness, and his problem lies outside, then we know for sure that this particular patient belongs to animal kingdom. And when we know that the patient belongs to animal kingdom or specific kingdom, our job becomes very, very easy, you know, the narrow down. So we have more than 5,000 remedies which are being proved, and on daily basis we are proving almost, you know, 20-30 remedies around the globe. So we don't know if we go by only repertory or go by only polycrest remedies, we never know that we can, you know, prescribe the newer remedies which are already proved there. So through by using this type of differentiation of kingdom or groupism, you would know that what kind of remedy I really need to prescribe, or what are the characteristics which I need in my remedy for this particular patient. So when you know that we need an animal remedy, then we have to differentiate amongst the sub kingdoms of the animal. So today we are talking about, there are 6-7 major subkingdoms like reptiles, birds and mammals, and mollusks, and you know, like the fishes and everything. So 6-7 subkingdoms are there in animal kingdom. So in animal kingdom, we are talking about one of the largest subkingdom, that is mammals. So we all know, you know, we all are doctors and we know that the word mammal comes from the Latin word mamma, and mamma means breast. So those people, those organisms which have breasts are called mammals. Okay, this is a very basic thing which I told you. So what are the possible human expressions of the animal, of the mammal kingdom? So first is need to belong to a group or herd. Okay, that's a very, very important thing. Okay. So need to belong to a group or a herd and paying the price for it. Issues of self versus the group. Issues of hierarchy, strong maternal instinct, and problems related to menses and lactation. Okay, so because they have the breast, so issues related to the breast they will have mostly. Okay, so lactation problems you will see, tenderness in the breast or pain in the breast before or after menses is a very, very strong indication for prescribing mammal remedies. Issues of hierarchy, issues of self and, you know, the group. Okay, so is my voice is better now?
It is still same actually, but it is very clear for me, and that's why I am not disturbing you actually.
Okay, but I can see the messages that it's a little low.
Yeah, it is clear actually. It is fine with actually the people having some problems. You can do deal. Some problems from out, some sounds from outside are coming. So if the windows close, then it will be okay.
Okay. Actually, I'm sitting in my clinic and there's a lot of traffic outside. I can't help
it. Yeah. No problem. You can tell me.
Okay. Yeah, I will keep, Dr. Padmaja, I will keep my mic closer and I'll try to talk as loud as possible. Thank you. Okay. So there is issue of hierarchy and they have very strong maternal instinct. So, you know, the group theme is very, very strong in mammals. And you will see, even if we see solitary mammals like, you know, lion or tiger or jackal or something like that, they also live with their babies. So because more than one is called as group, so group is very important thing, and there is a mother and child relationship even in the lone mammals. So you will see very strong maternal instincts, problems related to menses and lactation, they have a strong conflict with oneself, and they have the self-contempt, some dirty feeling about themselves, history of abuse you can see, and also a playfulness. So I will tell you each and everything that how it has evolved and how we can say these are the possible human expressions of mammal themes. This is just a summary which I want to tell you, and then we'll go further. So we can you know divide the mammals according to there's different taxonomical classification. So we can classify the mammals according to their energy, according to their strength, according to their vulnerability, according to their attack and defense mechanism, and according to whatever you want. Like, you know, I have classified mammals according to my own practice and my own experience. So for me, you know, the loner mammals are different, the big group mammals are different, the small group mammals are different. For me, the predators are different, preys are different. So we need to see or understand that what are the large group, and then in the group the smaller classifications to make our prescriptions more clear and easy, I would say. So we can differentiate any of animals you will see, you can differentiate them or classify them into prey and predator. Though all animals are preys for someone, and all are predators for someone. I am talking about the carnivorous animals. But in mammals, you will see that there will be a different energy of a predator mammal and different energy pattern of a prey mammal. So I am here differentiating according to a predator and prey. So in predator mammals, the large mammals, you will see all these things, the vigilance, stealth, alertness, open chase. You know, they are not like reptiles. Reptiles use a lot of camouflage and a lot of planning and plotting and you know, doing things. But with mammals, you will see, though they plan, because they are intelligent, they would plan, but they would go into a open chase. So it's an open confrontation with the opposition. Speed is also very important in predator mammals. So you just, you know, remember the example of a cheetah or a lion, which is a predator mammal. So speed. So cheetah runs and, you know, gets the prey, and he just likes this because the playfulness is also a very strong theme of mammals. So their problems or their characteristics would be matching of strength, power or challenge. And here the issue would be my strength versus your strength. So my strength versus their strength. That's the problem. So face-to-face challenge, wrestling, you know, just like wrestling. Wrestling is a game where, you know, people just come and say, you know, just hit me, come to me, and I will show you that what you can watch that WWF and WWE. That's really interesting. So a few important words you will see in predator mammals, that is pounce, leap, spring, suddenly, you know, desire for meat, because most of predator mammals are carnivorous. Some are herbivorous. Then this is the energy of a prey mammal. In prey mammals, you will see fright, freeze, you know, the reaction, fight or flight. There's always one reaction in the difficult situation, which we always say that either a person fight or flight. Take a flight. So in prey mammals, you will see they would get frightened very easily. So fright, freeze or hide. So they will just escape from the situation or from the predator. They are very, very vulnerable, too weak to defend themselves. They avoid or escape confrontation. They surrender themselves, submit or succumb out of a sheer fright. So you can, you know, just remember antelope or sheep or cow. They are prey mammals, generally the small ones. Then these are the main indications or the qualities of mammals, that first they live in herd, they live in group. So belonging to a group is very, very important. Then herd, community, they would talk about their community, society. They are social animals. Okay, you will see that you can just take our examples, our human beings. We call ourselves a social animal. Without society, we cannot live. And we all have experienced all the problems and psychosomatic, especially the psychological impact during the lockdown, because the society was cut off. The human touch was cut off. We were not able to express ourselves, and that was a big problem. These days, all the practitioners must have been busy in seeing the patients who are, you know, coming for anxiety and depression and all those things out of this lockdown. Because in lockdown, this human touch and communication was stopped somehow or decreased. So communication is also an important theme for mammals. Excluded, expelled, they feel that, you know, I'm excluded or I'm not included. So need to please is there, need to see is there. So like people has to see them, has to appreciate them. So belonging, they feel that this belonging to a group, part of the group. And also they want to be in the group because they feel safe. So their safety and security depends on the group. They feel included. They have a strong issues of hierarchy. So hierarchy is important in all the remedies of animal kingdom everywhere. But in mammals, the hierarchy is very complex and very, very stable also. So they would talk about high rank or high class or low rank or low class, superior, inferior, top rank. So if, you know, some person comes to you from MNC or he would tell you that, you know, I just want to get that promotion because having that class, that rank is very important for me, and I always compares myself with others, and I always, you know, I'm ambitious to get that class, get that rank. Then you can, you know, actually think about hierarchy and order and class. They would talk a lot about hierarchy, and their hierarchy is not that easy. It's a very, very complex hierarchy because mammals are the most evolved and most intelligent animals. So they would talk about supremacy. So in prey mammals, you will see that, you know, they feel abused. They are submissive. I told you that the fright, freeze and flee is their first reaction. They just want to escape, hide, and you know, go somewhere where the predator can't see them. Okay. Then other words which you can look for in prey mammals are these words: secluded, rejected, security, dictatorship, dominating, submission, anxiety, overpowering, run away. So run away is also very, very important. They just want to run away. Lie in wait, lurking, sneakily, alert. All these words are prey words. Okay, so here we'll come later. So we have some strong families. So there are many, many subfamilies in mammals. So I'm not going to talk about each and every family because that's a very, very lengthy topic. But of course, I will talk about some very important families which will help you in practice and which are the common commonly prescribed remedies in day-to-day practice. So these are common ones like, you know, Suidae family where pig comes, the Tylopoda where camel comes, Giraffidae where giraffe comes, Cervidae, Bovidae. In Bovidae, we have a lot of remedies like lac defloratum, goat, cow, buffalo, and lac buffalo, and like this. So we'll talk about the families also. But first, we need to understand that how do we know that this is for sure a mammal remedy or a mammal patient. So there is a constant dependence or independence conflict. Okay, so the major theme or the one most important theme which you need to remember in mammal cases is constant dependence and independence conflict, group conformity versus freedom. So they will always, you know, go in between where they are into group, where they are into group, what they are into group, and whether they are free or not. So there is a conflict between in the group or am I free. So freedom versus group conformity is the major thing in mammals. We understand that why dependence and independence is a major conflict. So because, you know, that is, they live in the group. So that is reflected in their language. They have this constant dilemma between needing the group and compromising their identity, freedom to be part of the group. So when you are in a group, of course you are safe. The group is providing you a safety and security, but at the same time you are losing your freedom. So group is of course important for survival, but when you need freedom or when you want to practice autonomy, then the group is a problem. So you will see a constant dilemma between whether I should be in the group, I should live with the group, or I should separate, live freely, but then I will lose the security. Sorry. Dependence on the group can bring the safety, but accompanying this is a requirement to submit to the group with the potential for abuse. So group, which is providing you security, also can abuse you and you lose your freedom, you lose your autonomy. So if you stay in the group, you get the security, but then you must submit to the hierarchy of the group. And if you leave the group, the problem is you have a comfort zone, you have this freedom that the group has to offer some mammals in nature and mammal remedies, then you have this feeling that do I have the capacity to be on my own? Okay, so when a group leaves you or you leave the group, you feel abandoned or you feel alone. At the same time, you have this comfort zone, you have the freedom, but then the question arises that do I have the capacity to live on my own, to be on my own? That's the most important thing. So, you know, the group gives you protection and security. So I always give this example of a joint family. So if you are living in a joint family, you know, you get all the values, you get that importance, but you have to sacrifice or compromise your freedom to do anything. Yeah. So this is the example of a joint family. But when you live in a nuclear family, you can do anything. But then your child is alone, you feel alone sometimes, you don't have that much of security, you don't have that much of wealth, but then you have a freedom. So this is, you know, being in the joint family or being nuclear is a constant dilemma. We can just, you know, understand from this example. So autonomy versus security. So here you can see, you know, on the left side we have a nuclear family with two kids and parents versus joint family. So joint family is providing a lot of security, but then the autonomy is going. Okay, so this is one of the best example from which I have learned how to understand mammal or mammal dilemma. Then they might tell you that, you know, I have the strength to be on my own, and can I sustain on my own? So, you know, they would talk about, yeah, I know I have a strength, but I still feel that, you know, if I live with a group, or if I stay in this company, or if I stay with my friends, I lose my freedom. Then still, but I feel the secure, I feel that they are providing me security or secure places there. So the constant conflict between being free or being dependent. Then relationship. So relationship is also a very, very important mammal theme, because if you are living in a group, it is but obvious that you would develop a relationship. So they would talk about relationship because it's a complex hierarchy. Talking about relationship, they bring out a lot of complexities and conflicts in those relationships. So you're not, you know, they might talk like this. I have just taken this example that they can talk about the love relationship, the parents relationship, or any relationship, and they would talk about whether I'm enjoying this relationship or not, whether I'm learning from this relationship or not, whether I get guidance or from this relationship or not. So you are not receiving guidance, not learning from their elders, their experiences, or something like that. And group is very important to them because the group provides everything. The group nurtures them. The group cares for them, and it takes the responsibility and love. So, you know, the receiving, guiding, learning, playing, loving, these are all the attributes of in being in the relationship. So in the relationship, we can see that different mammal or different lack remedies talk about different type of relationship problems when they come to us. Then comes communication. So I think I have missed a slide, just a minute. So communication is also a very, very important thing, because when you are living together, you are hunting together, you are mating together, so everything you are doing together, then the communication becomes very, very vital. So communication is also very vital for them. Just a second. Okay, so they want to, you know, they want to just communicate everything, every little thing, because they are doing everything together. So if a person comes to you and he says that he has a problem in communicating, or people don't understand him or her, and the communication is core of the case, then yes, you can think about a mammal remedy. You can definitely think about the lack remedies also. Communication is a very strong mammal theme, and also a bird theme. So here I want to clear one thing, that the bird also comes very close to mammals if we are talking about communication, because it's common in both of the subgroups, but in birds, communication is more one way. You know, you can see any bird around you and they would just, you know, sing for hours or minutes, and they are singing, they are just communicating, but they just want to sing and do something or talk something all the time. It's more one-way communication. For mammals, they would tell you that, you know, I am misunderstood, these people do not understand me, these people does not communicate with me, and they do not express, or I am not able to express or communicate my problem or my feeling. So it's more about feeling or communicating what you feel. In birds, it is not like that. In birds, it is, you know, basically one-way communication. So virtually, of course, you can see that that's a common theme, but you can easily differentiate when a patient comes to you. Then the mammals are extremely territorial in their nature. Okay, so you will see a lot of territory thing will be there. You know, this is my place, this is my desk, this is my area, this is my clan, this is not yours. Okay, then they would also talk about, you know, this person has snatched away my place or my things. So territory and hierarchy comes hand in hand. And they are also, they feel that whenever they are vulnerable or endangered, you know, all these issues are interlinked, and they would talk a lot about that, I am vulnerable, I'm not able to do this, or I'm not able to communicate this to someone. So communication, competition, vulnerability, everything comes together. So there is a lot of complexity in mammals. So understanding their cases, it is not that hard, I would say, not very difficult, but of course the complexity will, you know, will give you a kind of a little, I would say, a doubt, because in complexity you get lost in so many things. But don't get lost, just remember that because they are highly evolved, the complexity comes in the case. Okay, so there are some common questions from which, you know, you can just identify the mammal cases. Whenever you are heard, I just want to tell you that whenever you heard the whole story, whenever you are done with the case, or you have heard the patient's story, then you can ask one very, very important thing to a patient. If you get one or two stressful situation or overwhelming situation, you just ask a patient, what is his or her experience of that situation? And he would give you the characteristics or qualities of the remedy, of the source directly. So if, you know, someone says hello. That...
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah.
Sorry for the interruption. Actually, slides are not changing. I think it's stuck.
Yeah, yeah. I have not changed the slide. Don't worry. I'll change it.
It's communication slides, right?
Yeah, yeah, same relationship and complication. Yeah.
Okay, ma'am. Then, okay, you can proceed.
Yeah. So, if he is telling you a stressful situation, or an overwhelming situation, or a recent stressful situation. So, if you ask about recent stressful situation, you will definitely know that which kingdom or which sub kingdom he belongs to, because this, whenever there is stressful situation and person is behaving in certain order or certain way, then you should know that this is the most uncompensated state of him. So whenever, you know, you have to take all the characteristics which are not taught by someone to him, or you know, he has not gained out of his experience, it should be uncompensated, directly coming from the subconscious. So to make this statement clear, I want to give you one example of pediatric cases. So what I do in pediatric cases is, so whenever a pediatric case comes to me, I would ask the parents that how is the nature of a child, and of course we all ask about the nature and life space and everything. And when I ask about the nature of a child, that the parents will say, no, he's a very good child, just that he gets angry often or sometimes, or he's a little irritable, but he's a very good child. So I would tell them that, you know, of course he's a very good child, but you tell me something which is not taught to him, which you have not taught, nobody, you know, school has not taught, which has come since birth, so which is not altered at all. So I just want to know that what is that trait or that quality which is there, which was always there. So I had this one of the case, I would tell you the lack case only, and I asked this was a child of, I guess, 10 or 11 years old female, and she came to me for some muscular pains, and the mother narrated the story that, you know, this happened, that happened, and then she started having this pain, and the child was very alert and very nice and quite you know, attractive, communicating, and she was a very, very intelligent child also. So I just asked mother that tell me one thing which you have not taught her and she has gained herself, and this quality is present since birth. So she told me, you know, doctor, one thing which I want to tell you is, after, you know, thinking a lot, she told me that one thing which I have observed since her birth is, when she was even 9 months old, she started walking only when she was nine months or 10 months old. She started walking very early, and since the childhood, we have seen that in last 10 years or 9 years, she has never fell down. So she is the girl, I always feel, you know, she jumps from here and there, and when she was young, she used to jump from sofas and, you know, from staircase and from everything, and we used to fear that, you know, she will just fall down, or she would get injured, and I would always advise her that please don't jump, and she would still jump, and then her feet are so strong that she would jump but she would not fall down, she would just, you know, just go down, but I have never seen she is being injured by these things, though she just likes jumping. So this mother told me that she likes jumping and she never fell down, and you know, this the remedy which I wanted to prescribe for this case was lac felinum, and this connected so very well, and later I actually understood in this particular case that this little girl of 10-11 years old was a real runner, and she was an athlete actually, she used to run. But since her birth, her footwork was very, very strong, and this footwork or strong claw work is a great sign of cats, you know. There you can see domesticated cats around you, and they just jump from, I have seen a cat near in my neighborhood, and she used to jump from first floor, and I never see her falling down or having an injury, because their claws are very strong, their footwork is very strong. So, you know, these type of things which are not taught, these days we are just forcibly making our children so-called civilized, and we are just taking their traits away, the natural traits. So we need to know as a physician the natural traits of a person, the underlying deeper pattern. So that's why I told you this example, that you have to also look for a deeper pattern, a deep with that, a trait or a quality which is not taught to a patient, which is always there, and that will give you a exact source sign or source signature. Okay, so what is the experience of the patient is first question, then one trait which is not taught to him, that will also give you a very good clue about which type of remedy you need. Then of course, fears and dreams is also a very important thing. The fears and dreams, in fears are also the most uncompensated thing, and dreams are also most uncompensated thing, because it comes directly from the subconscious. And if a person is having a dream of, you know, urinating or passing stool, he won't change it. But if he has really passed a stool or really have this involuntary urination, he would feel shy to tell you. So in dreams, they won't, you know, just alter it, and they would tell you directly. So that's the most important thing. So explore fear in dreams, explore hobbies and interests, because your hobbies are, you know, the most uncompensated thing, because you cannot change your hobbies. If you like music, you like music. If you like playing games, you like playing it. You don't change it, and you need not to. Okay. So this is how you can, you know, we can see all the traits in mammals. Then I would always say, I say that, you know, the mammals are like treasure box. They need to have groups, you know. You can have your own groups, like I told you, the vivacious group, the talkative group, the expressive group, loud group, less expressive group, or reserved group, like this. So we need to prove all the mammals. Kent already has said this. Milk is the beginning of life, and from most of the mammals, we have the lacs, which are proved. We also have some mammal remedies where the blood of the mammal is used, but mostly the lacs, the milks. So milk is the beginning of life and is the most important fundamental thing which is used in first year of life. So they know how to live in a group. Yeah. So reason one can domesticate a mammal is that they can form a bond. They produce babies and they can live in a group. They give to the live ones. They give birth to live ones. So constant need for a group. And if it is not a group, it would be mother and child. So need to belong. Then we have all these mammals, which are the known ones like cats, bears, whales, bats, you know. So we can divide or classify the mammals according to their place to live, like aerial mammals, the water mammals, land mammals, but they all live in the group. So they have this group thing always there. So for first few years, child lives with the mother, and that also forms a bond. So bonding, relationship, and living together becomes very important. Need to be liked by the group. So, you know, I have attended few lectures of Dr. Bhavisha Joshi, who has also written a book on mammals, and it's a wonderful book. You should go through. So she always used to say, you know, that you can miss a reptile. That's not a problem. You can miss mollusk. You can miss something else, you know. In your backyard, you can miss a reptile. You can miss a snake. But you cannot, if you have a sheep or a cow or a, you know, even a rat, you can't miss that. You will always see that. So that's the major theme of mammals. Need to be liked or need to be seen. So they don't go unnoticed. You have to notice them. And they like to get noticed. And that's how we cannot miss them. So it's very easy, you know, to pick the mammal. They are submissive to the group, need to take care of the group. Group is hurting them. That is also an important theme of mammal, that because they live in the group, their problem also starts with group. So group might be hurting them. Group is the problem. So group becomes very important. They deal with all these issues, you know. First is who you are in the group. Who are you? Who dominates you, who you submit to. So you choose, you know, who submits to you or who you will submit. So you have to, you know, see in, there is a whole hierarchy that first we need to know who are you in this group. Then they need to know who dominates you. Then who submits to you. Then identity is also an important issue for them, because identity, being seen, being appreciated, you know, being themselves is also an important theme. So they share, they talk, and they would tell you, you know, this is me, this is my position. So we need to see that what is their position? Is their position as a somebody or anybody or what? What exactly is their position in the group? And that will tell you which mammal we need to prescribe. So mammals have good amount of self-esteem and security from the group. Why good amount of self-esteem? Because, like I said, you know, they are the evolved one. Which book? Yes, Mammals by Dr. Bhavisha and Sachindra Joshi. Yes. So I will show you the book later, because that's near, next to me. So feeling of being seen, being neglected, you know, high self-esteem, these are the important traits. Desire to be heard. You know, we always say, you are not listening to me, you're not hearing to me, or my friend is not paying attention to me. So being attentive or being heard is a very important theme of mammals. They have feeling, why can't people listen to me? Need of appreciation is too much. So, you know, example of tiger and leopard, both are the top of the predators, the top predators, but still in leopards they won't talk about, you know, they are not listening to me, their communication is the problem, relationship is the problem. They will say that, you know, see, I am superior, I know this. But these people are not ready to accept my superiority. They don't understand that, you know, what a good leader I am, how I lead. And the tiger won't say all these things. Tiger is a leader and he knows his self-worth. Lachesis is being a snake, being a reptile. He just wants to hide himself or escape from the situation or just camouflage. But tiger, they would come, confront, and need of appreciation is too much because he's a king of a jungle. Lachesis can't be, in spite of being a top predator. So both are powerful, both are king predators, both are like sixth row, but mammals are so visible, so seen, not like reptiles. So simple, like I gave you an example of Dr. Bhavisha, that, you know, in backyard one can find a venomous snake, but not a tiger. So because tiger doesn't go unnoticed. In Australia, you know, they have this huge backyards and you can easily find a snake. Even in Indian villages, you know, people say, you know, ghar se saap nikla, there was a snake in my house, and in the farms also, it's so easy. Insects can be hidden. So insecta is one of the subkingdom of animals, but they are hidden, mostly hidden. You can't see a spider very easily, you know. You will see only when you are just cleaning your house or office. So these are very, very, the mammals are very close to you, know. With mammal, you know, this goat and cow and sheep, they can't be hidden. They will not go unnoticed. This is a theme of being appreciated and being noticed. So these are all our lovely mammals. Keywords are herd, community, family, society. They can also talk about caste, because caste is also a group for them, clan, friend circle, social animal, belong to a group, included, excluded, expelled, safe in a group, not safe in a group. So like I said, independence and dependence conflict, constant dilemma, sense of security. Then relationship also becomes very, very important. Strong maternal instinct, because they also want guidance and nurturing up to a certain age. Like if in humans we talk, then in humans up to 1 or 2 years of age, you need that proper nurturing, just like a womb. Communication, very, very important, because they live together, hunt together, they communicate their feelings, they love, care and share. Home is also a very important theme, because, you know, it's also an important theme because many mammals make their houses by themselves. Home is not a building for them. It's just like a safe place whenever they feel, you know, endangered or vulnerable or like this. Need a lot of parental care, or they provide extreme parental care to the young ones, like this, like not the second case. I have not told you the case. I will tell you the case now. So many issues are interlinked, not simple like minerals. So I just like to tell you that, you know, minerals are very, very simple. So generally, you know, I just make this joke that mineral cases are very boring cases. But jokes apart, of course, mineral cases are simple cases. They have only one issue, and not like animals or not like mammals. So in mammals, the problem is within, the issues are interlinked and very, very complex. Also, one can see the proper attack and defense mechanism. So if you have reached to the experience of a patient in the specific situation, then you will see that he will give you some source qualities. So he might talk about the mammals' attack and defense mechanism also. So whenever, you know, I get this lag defloritum or lag buffalo kind of things, I ask them, in that particular situation, what was your reaction? And they would tell you that, you know, I just want to escape. I just want to leave that place. I just want to fly away. I just don't want to be there. And if you see lion cases, they just feel like, you know, I was so angry, just I just wanted to tear apart that person. I didn't do that, but I wanted to do that. So they would tell you the attack and defense mechanism. So attack mechanism is very, very clear when they tell you, because they are the most evolved ones. So intelligence is also a very important theme in mammals. So here is our summary to understand mammal remedies: communication, groupism, dependence, family or herd, the relationships, the complex hierarchy, need to be accepted, fight for supremacy, and conflict with oneself. And they are very, very self-critical people, because intelligent, then they, you know, tend to criticize even themselves. So these are some common lac remedies, like lac caninum, lac caprinum, delphinum, equinum, felinum, humanum. There are many lac remedies. I have not used every remedy, but I will tell you a few remedies which I have used and I have experience with. Okay, so one thing I want to make you clear is there are many families in the lacs. So in mammal, you will see a lot of families, but there are n number of families in almost 25, 50. But I would like to talk about few common ones or few important ones so that you understand it better. So first we talk about the bovidae family. Okay, so bovids, like sheep and, you know, these people. So they are cloven hoofed, split into two toes. They move in large groups. They are not that territorial. You know that they have the distinct pecking order, and they also wrestle, a violent display of power. So you must have seen this picture where the two sheep are, you know, fighting with each other. So bovids. So the common keywords of bovids, because I am telling you this family because this is a most important, one of the most important mammal family, which is widely used in practice. So they are docile, they are extremely docile, they are submissive, they are subservient, they are meek, very meek people. They sacrifice, and even, you know that for few religious things, these mammals are also used as for sacrifices. So this feeling of being sacrificed or sacrificing something will come into the picture. Comply, they're very compliant. You know, they abide by the rules. Whatever they tell, you will tell them, they would do. They are very vulnerable. You know, there is in Hindi, there is one saying, bed chal. You know, we do bed chal. So what is bed chal is just abiding by whatever the leader is saying, not thinking or not putting your brain or using your intelligence. Fleeing, flight. So their main defense mechanism is flight. They just go away from the situation. Yeah. Then pliable is also one thing. Okay. So next comes one order, which is also important. Perissodactyla, which is horses, zebras, and donkeys. Yeah. So the family is equidae. So in equidae, what happens is the perissodactyla means odd number of fingers or toes. So they have, you know, odd number of fingers or toes. They are very, very fast runners because they have this, you know, number of fingers or toes with which they can run. So they are also known as the beasts of burden. We all know, we call it in Hindi, we call it Gadha Hamali. So what is Gadha Hamali? You know, we always say he's a donkey work. So donkey work is just taking the burden and doing it and doing it. So they are beasts of burden. They carry very heavy weight on the middle toe. They are very, very agile. And generally, they are solitary. So except horses and donkeys, generally all others are like zebras. They are solitary. These animals are very graceful, powerful, and swift. So you will see a lot of, you know, speed issues with them. or they would talk about burden, or if he's a horse patient, he would talk about strength and running and fleeing and speed and all these things. They are very, very sure-footed. Okay, these people are very sure-footed, especially the donkey. Then there is this family rhinoceros, where rhinoceros come. Okay, then we have tapirs, where we have ik, which I have already talked about. Okay, then we have a lagomorpha order, where the rabbit comes, like oryx is the remedy, oryctolagus, and rodentia is also, yes, in rodentia, very important remedy comes, which is rattus. So rattus is not a milk, it's a blood of a rat, and it is proved by Dr. Jayesha only, he's my mentor also. But rattus is a very important remedy, and it should be actually more commonly used. We don't use it very often. I don't know much about it, but of course it's a very nice remedy. Then in rodentia, these are the keywords. So few keywords I would tell you. In rodents, you will see, you know, gnaw, chewing, nibbling, digging, burrowing, because they live in the burrows, excavating, climber, tunnel. They would talk about eroding, quill, barb, nettle-like, bristly, thorn. All these keywords will be there in the rodent family. Then we have primates. So primates, we have this characteristic that they possess five fingers, okay? Opposing thumbs, short fingernails, just like us, long inward closing fingers, forward facing, color binocular vision. They are chiefly vegetarian and very social. Okay, so altruism is very important theme here. Very curious creatures, learn a lot of things through imitation. They have a good grip. They use tools, makes tools and weapons. So they are one of the most intelligent ones. Okay. Then we come to, you know, you can also classify mammals in, or not only mammals, in any animals, you can classify them in herbivorous and carnivorous. So order Carnivora is one of the biggest order in mammals. Meat eaters and excellent runners. So I will tell you what is the basic difference between herbivores and carnivores. In carnivorous animals, you will see a lot of stealth and lot of strong power than herbivores. And herbivorous animals are mostly, not all, but mostly they are the prey mammals. And in carnivora, you will see they are mostly the predator ones. So one thing which is very important is they're excellent runners. They run very rapidly. They just sprint. Energy resources, resting for long periods, and cunning ambush techniques following into a short, violent rush to make a kill. You know, just like a lion. Lion is a very, very heavy animal. It's you know, almost a 1 ton, 1,000 or 1,200 or 1,500 kgs animal. And what he actually does is he just takes very, very long rest period, sleeps for days together. And then whenever he feels hungry, he just, you know, come into the jungle, and then he would just go violently and just kill an animal, feed himself, because he just don't want to, you know, waste his energy. That's the thing. Then they have strong speed and strength. Predation is very important. So the skull, the claws, the teeth are adopted for predation because they are mostly the large predators. Okay, so before family, there is this differentiation of super family. So before family, there is this super family. One is Caniformia, which is dog-like, and one is Paliformia, which is cat-like. So two main subfamilies are there, which one is felids and one is canids. But in felids and canids, some other family members are also kept, and that's why the super family is made. So in Caniformia, or dog-like family, we have all these canids, like dog, wolf, fox, jackal, and also bears, skunk, and whistle. And in cat-like family, along with felids, like along with lion, cheetah, tiger, and domestic cat, of course, we have also kept hyenas and mongoose. So we will talk only about the common ones, not the uncommon ones. So main theme of the carnivora order is power, challenge, stealth, chasing, and grabbing. So power and challenge, they just do this open chase and confront each other and challenge each other. So commonest words for carnivora is pounce upon, leap upon, spring, suddenly. So there is a lot of suddenness, grab, ripped apart, tear down, or claw down. These are very, very important themes in fears, in dreams, in anger situations, in stressful situation. You will see all these words in the patients. And if you are getting these words, think about the carnivorous. It can be felids, it can be canids, but the carnivorous mammal. Then these are the keywords. They are extremely ferocious mammals. They just want to, you know, tear apart. And you can watch one or two videos on YouTube where, you know, you can see a lion or fox or jackal when they are actually hunting. They just tear apart the animal, clawing down. Their claws are very, very strong. Charge towards, they spring suddenly. So they, you know, come out of nowhere and just tear apart an animal. Swift, overpower, okay? Sneakily, all these words are there. Then stealth, ambush attack is a very important attack mechanism of carnivores. Ambush, power, pounce. Ambush you will see in reptiles also. But in that, you will see a lot of planning and plotting, not like mammals. Leap, chase, attack, grab, rip, meet. Okay, then we have from the Caniformia family, we have this Canidae, which is canids, very important family. So they walk on their toes, okay? Digitigrades, we call it. So they walk on their toes, adapted more for endurance than speed, and then they can pursue their prey over long distances. Okay, so they just pursue their prey, they just go behind their prey, and until it tires down. They are pack animals, except the fox, which is solitary. Okay, so pack animals, except the fox. Fox is quite solitary, other than most of the canids are live in the packs. They hunt in a pack. Yeah. Strict social hierarchy. They have very, very strict social hierarchy. Though they are competitive, there is also sharing and accepting dominance of one over the other for the welfare of the pack. So the sense of security is also very high in them. So for security, they live in this under the dominance. Then what are the possible human expressions? So strict social hierarchy, they would talk about, you know, he's superior to me, he's inferior to me. They dominate me in the office, they dominate me in the house. A feeling of being looked down upon. So in Lacan, we all know that this is a very strong feeling of looked down on. Yeah, they feel that, you know, they are being looked down and despised. An intense desire to be seen or to be superior than others. So there is a lot of suppression, especially in domesticated dog. So all the dogs you will see, they strive to achieve a higher position, a greater rank in an office or organization. Interdependence is there. Subservience is there. They are very obedient. They are very loyal. You know, we always tell this that the dogs are the best friend of humans. Why they are best friend? Because they are very loyal and obedient. And they believe in teamwork. They are very, very good in teamwork. Individually, they are incapable because they know that this is a limit of mine. I can't achieve that much. But in the teamwork, with the team, I can hunt more, I can get more, I also get the security. So in that way, they are interdependent. You know, it's just like a relay race. In relay race, you just hand over your bat to the next player. So group, team, combined effort, hierarchy, ranking, high rank, low rank, boss, top dog, you know, the low dog, share, sharing, submissive, obedience, all these are keywords. Cunning is also a keyword. Loyalty, endurance, contrive. Other words are ranking, top rank, low rank, top level, high level, low class, high class, bow down, fidelity, planning, deceit. So lack can, for example, that lack can loyalty is towards a superior. In spite of being abused and tortured, they feel a lot of torture inside, but they still feel that, you know, they have to be loyal towards their superior. Then we have lack lupinum, which is wolf. Teamwork or cooperative effort is there, but there is opportunistic behavior also. Hierarchy is pronounced, concerned about their position in the group. So they are very, the wolf is very cunning actually. Fox is also very cunning. The fox is the most cunning one out of canids. Cunningness, slyness, and deceit are the way of the fox. Then there is Jekyll, issues related to bondage between the partners, a role of helper in the group. That is Jekyll. And then Colte, which is lesser known, easy adaptability and also versatile. Then we come to the cats. So cat family, that is felids. In felidae, they are strictly carnivorous. Not even one is herbivorous, strictly carnivorous. So it comprises of two main species. One is felis and other is the panthera. So tiger is not totally a cat, but it is included actually. Okay, little slow. Okay. So members of the family felidae is the lion, the tiger, cheetah, jaguar, puma, domesticated cat, which we all have seen and experienced with lynx and leopard and panther. So these are all the members of the felidae family. The main characteristics is we all know that usually they are solitary, except the lion. Lion has a strong mother and child bond, and the lion hunts for the family and live together and like this, and they have the smaller large groups also. But the most of the felids are known for their lift and agility. So agile is one thing. Sprinting is also highly developed. Like I told you this example of a little girl who never fell down, you know, a child who has never get injured because of, you know, falling down from, so even after jumping from sofas and jumping from first floor and from staircase and everything. So sprinting is important. Running, sprinting is a very highly developed ability of the feline group. And that's how, you know, my prescription was 200% sure in that particular case. When I got to know, and this girl was a very, very good runner. She was actually into racing and athletics. So she used to, you know, really like this racing and everything. They are very good climbers. So all these mountaineers and athletic people who come to you and they would talk about their muscular soreness or any problem, if they have this ability to climb or to sprint or to run and they are agile, you can definitely think about the felines. They hunt, they have very, very keen eyesight. Initially, they stalk a person, a short burst of chase. So mainly, they target the neck of the prey by their claws with the sharp canines, and they just tear apart. So they obstruct the air passages. So here, you know, they are a little similar with the reptiles, which kill by suffocation. So these people also kill by suffocation, so making others suffocated. Claws are highly adaptable for tearing and grasping, and there is also a retractable claws. You know, there is a retractable claw present in felite except in sheep. So power, speed, ambush, and strong sense of independence. This I forgot to tell you, that in felites you will see strong sense of independence. In fact, in lack of animal, we see that's the only remedy the domestic cat, which has domesticated herself for you know for the easy availability of the food. Otherwise, it exercises its own rule. Even you know you can have a dog as your pet and tie him with a chain, but you cannot tie a cat with a chain. She would just run away. So strong sense of independence and elegance is also there. They're very elegant, you know. Need to be powerful, strong, wanting to control others. The issue is, who is more powerful, you or me? So the speed is there. Felids sprint in order to pursue their prey. A passion for speed and pace. Stealth, the chief means of attack, is suddenly attacked from nowhere. A surprise attack. A surprise element is there, suddenly from out of the blue. So I had this patient of Lac Leoninum, I would tell you, and she was a architect, and in her office some politics was going on. It was a big architecture firm, and she told me that doctor, I knew that I had to get a promotion, but somehow the office people, because of the politics and everything, they thought that some other guy got the promotion. And also this lady felt that she did not get promotion because they were feeling little, competitive, because she was a woman, and they wanted to give a promotion to only a male guy and something like that. So this all promotion story was there, where she did not get a promotion because of the office politics and whatever, her boss felt or her higher management felt. And she did something to make them, understand her self-worth. And she actually planned everything, and she said, out of nowhere, they actually understood my worth. And I told them that, I'm going to search a new job and just leaving your company because you don't value my work and you don't value my ideas. And she actually did something from which she got this promotion from the hand of this guy, which has got the promotion just 2-3 days back. So within 2-3 days, she actually proved her worth, because she knew that, and she did not feel bad about it. She told me that, suddenly I planned this and they gave me this promotion. I said, it's so quick, within 2-3 days, what did you do? She said, I did something. And that was a point for me where I understood that suddenly from out of the blue, she did something which she did not tell me, but she managed to get that promotion out of the hand of someone who has already got it. Okay. So this type of sudden surprise attack is there in felids. They're very territorial, just like other mammals. So my domain, my area, like this lady, she told me, this is my domain. I need to get it. Otherwise it's not possible. Strong sense of independence, accuracy, being great achievers and always being right on the target. They are very, very accurate. Gracefulness. So whenever you see a lion or a tiger or any cat, you will always feel a lot of grace in them. Gracefulness and elegance. I always remember this movie whenever I prescribe or teach felids, that is Lion King. So if you see that lion where what is his name, I guess Simba, Simba was a son of Mufasa. He's very, very elegant and graceful in his attitude and expression. They're very fastidious. They like cleanliness, and this grabbed ear claws and sharp teeth is always there. So these are the keywords which I have already told you. Attack from nowhere, ambush, power, speed, chase, sprint, ferocious, domain, elegance. All these things are there. Other words are suddenness, unaware, lurk, still hunt, waylay, sneakily, lethal attack, and hot chase. They will always tell you that this was a chase between me and my profession, or me or my colleague, or whoever it is. So there's a lot of dignity, and they will tell you that, I am, and you will feel whenever they will come to your clinic or cabin, and you will see that you feel that this is a dignified or respected person, and he has a lot of grace in his actions. Okay, so this is all about the important families or super families of the mammals. I hope you got it. And now I will just go towards some lack remedies, which I really feel, you know, we all should know. Okay, so first remedy is lack Loxodonta africana. So can anyone tell me what is this remedy and which mammal's milk is this, if anyone knows? Elephant. Oh, Dr. Mustafa, thank you. So first answer is correct, of course. So lack Loxodonta africana. Yes, Simran Arora, yes, thank you. So you are right, you know about this remedy, lack Loxodonta africana. It's African elephant's milk, actually. That's why it is called as africana. So elephants, you know, one of my favorite animals. I always love watching them. And if you also watch them, you will feel that grace, that leadership quality, and the group thing will be there. So you can watch some videos of African elephants, and there you will see that they have impatience. You will see a lot of high self-esteem. Okay, they are very good leaders. They are extremely social. They have quite big groups, and I have seen, you know, in this elephants, you will see that the leader elephant will only feed herself or himself after each and every member of his group has eaten everything. Like, you know, they are done with their meal, and then only they would eat themselves, because their leadership qualities are really good. So they would, you know, I have seen the packs of elephants going to together, they're large. You get amazed by their order and their discipline and sociability, and they're really playful with each other. Extremely social animals. So they are, though they are very big hunters, I mean big mammals, but still they stay in big groups. They're extremely social. They love a lot. They love to do for others. They love to guide. Feeling of leadership, as if everything is dependent on them, is very strong theme of lack Lox. Physically also, they are extremely powerful and strong. They have very strong responsibility, dominating and authoritative. Okay. Then I have seen some cases where people have behaved, you know, in anger, they have behaved very ruthlessly and extremely angry if the situation is unjust or some, you know, unfair thing is happening or some injustice is happening. But still I have seen that in spite of being that angry or that irritable or behaving in certain way, they are still respected in their society, in their group. And you feel that respect for those patients. Even if they are coming to your clinics, you will see that grace and their leadership quality due to their caring nature. They're very, very caring. So I just want to give you an example of my one of my professor, and she was a very nice lady, and I have prescribed her at one point of time. She actually talked to me, and she had some problem, and for that problem I prescribed her lack Lox. And how I prescribed, I'll tell you. It was a very funny incident. So I have always seen her in my college days also. She used to, you know, cook a lot of meals, and she used to bring that meals to the college and feed all the students and faculties and everyone. And she used to, you know, just love caring for people. She was a very, very caring lady. Though she was a professor and she was very senior, when I was in college, she was in her 60s or something. And still, she was such a good doctor, very caring and social person, and she used to feed everyone. So recently when she came to me, because I remembered this whole thing, I took the case, of course. And after that, because of this particular quality of caring, nurturing and feeding people and love to communicate, and she was also a little authoritative, of course, I prescribed her lack Lox, and her whole problem went off. And there was a very nice case for me because she has all the characteristics of elephant. And she always used to, you know, live in the group. Locke's animal is elephant. Okay. So they're almost like a father figure or a mother figure in the surrounding. So this lady was also, most of the time she used to behave like a mother figure to most of the students in the college. And she used to cook the food, feed the food. And she used to do a lot for the students. You know, even for girls, she used to keep sanitary pads in her department so that, you know, if something happens to someone or a menses appears, she would, you know, just provide that pads to people. And this much or this level of caring she had. So, and also in her whole attire or her behavior, she was very gentle. So this is just an example of a case. So these people who belongs to or who needs this remedy of elephant's milk are very gentle. They need for the group. They are very playful, sociable. They make friends easily. They like to do the teamwork and like to lead the team. And also one very common trait which I have learned and also seen in few of the cases that they have sharp memory of events and feelings of connection with their ancestor. So they always feel connected with their ancestors and they have very sharp memory for events happened to them. They need guidance. So in vulnerable situation, you will see that they also need, though they are able to guide, but they need guidance or love or care or nurture from others. So that is Locke's. Okay, so this is about elephant's milk. Now we'll go to a little, you know, common remedy, which is dog's milk or wit's milk, I should say, lac caninum. So like I said, I told you about the family also, the Canidae family, where, you know, so these are the mammals who are first domesticated, you know, this is the family which was domesticated for the first time because they were very loyal. They have this need to please. Okay, so I'm getting some questions. I will address this question in the last. One question I want to address is, do we observe obesity as a feature in Locke's? So
no. You can complete it, Dr. Amni, you can complete it. Then we can take the question, no problem.
Yeah, okay. So in Lacan, you will see that they are the domesticated ones. So need to please, because they live in the group, they live with you. So you will see always, you know, dogs, if they are living in the living inside your house or with you, they would always come to you and they would please you. You know, they would lick you, love you, just cuddle you and do things which you will really like. If you want to play, they would play. If you want to sit with them, cry, they would just sit there. So they are the loyal friends of human beings. They are very loyal people. They have this strong herd. They hunt and stay together. And the very important thing which you will see in few cases of yours for sure, that is olfaction is very strong. Olfaction is very strong in them. And you will see some traits in human beings also. There is a lot of suppression of anger. Suppression of anger or suppression of emotion is there in Lacan. They are always dependent on master. They need to please. They need support, care from friends, near ones. The group is very important for them. Suppressed anger, you will see. Neglected and forsaken. They always feel, you know, they are not appreciated, neglected, forsaken. Fear of being rejected is there. Okay, so that's all about Lac caninum. I am not talking much about Lac caninum because we all know that, you know, the look down upon, the loyalty and the suppressed anger. We know everything about Lac can. So we should go ahead with other remedies which we don't know. So one remedy which is very, very important remedy. I want to tell you this remedy I have started using recently from last. I should say from maybe 4-5 years or something like that, not beyond that. Though I'm practicing from last 12 years, but I never knew about this remedy. I never knew the feeling of this remedy. And this is such a useful remedy. For I have prescribed it more often in women and people who feel, you know, worthless, people who feel that they are not appreciated and they have a very, very passive aggression. So feeling of being stupid and worthless is a most important feeling. And it is a very common remedy, which we should use very, very often because we get such type of cases where people feel burdened and people are just like CPR, you know. The CPR feeling is, you know, you are undertaking things opposed to your intentions. You are doing all the household things which you might not be doing because you don't like it, but you have to do it. So this is a mundane routine thing. So in Lag Asylum also, we all know that, you know, the donkeys, the whole world sees to the donkey and says it's a stupid, it's a buddhu animal. Yeah, this buddhu-ness, the stupidity or being worthless is a very important theme of Lag Asylum. It comes from donkey's milk. So feeling stupid and worthless. Worthless is the strongest feel I have seen in these type of cases. Burdened. Often they are dismissed of everything, of their opinion, of their presence, anything. Though they are very, very intelligent animals, actually they belong to a group of horses. So they are just like the horses, but they are not valued like horses because, you know, with horses, you can have this chase and you can earn money and things like that. But though we take a lot of work, a lot of jobs done from donkey, but we don't value them. So they have this passive aggression. They feel unappreciated and disregarded despite their intelligence. They are insulted repeatedly, rejected. But still, these people don't retaliate. They don't retaliate. They won't say, you know, you are using me or abusing me. So abuse is also a very, very important word. Though they feel abused, they won't retaliate. So their anger and resistance is always suppressed. They're calm and they always prefer, you know, being passive than confront someone. So donkeys, they are unsuccessful. People see them as unsuccessful performers, though they outperform themselves, whom everyone pushes and bullies. So bullying is also one of the major themes of Lag Asylum. Their feeling is this life is routine, mundane, and they just want to break free. Okay, they just want to break free. It's the opposite polarity of feeling stuck in a mundane routine. Also, you will see a lot of stubbornness in donkeys. They won't retaliate, but they would stick to whatever they are doing. So they are in some manner, they are stubborn in their nature. They are also very intelligent. They can handle situations, but indulged in, you know, this mundane routine. When they are cornered, they actually, whenever they are cornered, in animals you will see, or in patients also you will see, that whenever they are cornered badly, they can actually kick, you know, we say that, no, the kick ass off. So they kick so hard that they can kill the predator. So their kicks are really, really bad. But this doesn't happen often. And in patients also, we see low self-esteem and, you know, fear of being rejected and mundane routine and suppressed anger and all these things. So this was about donkey. Now we will talk about a brother of a donkey, which is horse. So Lag Equinum. So horses are also made domestic many thousand years ago. So if you see the history of horses, of their domestication history, it's very bad. Actually, they have, like you must have seen this, that, you know, with horses, they just put them into a small space of paddock or something like that. And after that, they use the horses for races. So in race, they have to, you know, they put the money on the horse which runs fast, and it runs out of pain. They don't like running. So in person, in horses, if you see, they don't like running. They like running only for a shorter distance, not like the commercial races. So in lac equinum, you will see large prey feeling. Though they are large animals, but they are prey, not predators. Though they have a lot of, strength and ability and speed and everything, still they are very dependent. So theme of dependence and independence is there. Performance is very important for them. So they just want to perform to make their master happy. And they also want to please their master. Power, strength are bigger themes in that. Desire to be best in every way. High self-esteem. Confident, target-oriented people. So that is a basic difference between a donkey and a horse, though it comes very, very close. But still, a donkey has a very low self-esteem. A horse has a very high self-esteem. And they're confident people. They were exploited badly. So they were always, this I have learned from Dr. Gandhi, that he always talks about, whenever he talks about lac equinum, he would tell us that whenever war happens, so whenever we remember wars or war happens on the earth, we always talk about how many lives we have lost. We don't talk about how many animals we have lost, or we always talk about, money or human beings, but not about the mammals, not about the animals which we have lost. So likewise, they are used in battles. So in the wars also, in the battles also, we lose, or we have used horses badly, or I would say abused horses badly. They are pushed and pulled heavy carriages. So they don't want to do it, but they are made pushing or pulling heavy carriages. They are abused in the farms. Also in the farms, abuse is very important theme in horses. In whole equity, I would say, whole equity. They love to run, weeping with running. You can see, if you see a race or a horse running, you can see the tears flowing down from the eyes of the horse. So they want to please their master. So, this is the contradiction here, that though they love to run, also, they weep along with running, but along with that, they want to please their master. So they are, like I told you, that they are kept in a small paddock to make them run, but their energy is pent up over there. Their anger is pent up. And that's how, they just make them free during a race or just before the race. And they use, for running, they use this pent up energy. So this energy is released in the race. So they made to do a job which is beyond their capability, beyond their capability to perform that particular job. They would take up things which are beyond. So also in patients, you will see that a lot of patients talk about their jobs which they are doing is, out of their capacity or capability. So they also like to take it as a challenge, but at the same time, that is beyond their capacity. So, kind of contradiction or duality also. They would run for life. They love horses also, just like cats. They have a very strong footwork, very sure-footed, but donkeys are more sure-footed than horses. So if you go on mountains and, things like that, they don't use horses in spite of being good runners, they would use donkeys, so that they are more sure-footed. You don't fall down and things like that. So when they are whipped, act of running put a lot of. Whenever they are whipped, they run. So, but this act of running put a lot of strain on their heart. So that's a very difficult thing for them. They are badly abused. They feel totally exhausted. And once they are not useful, they would be killed. So in proving also, the usefulness comes very prominent. So these people would often come to you and talk about, whether I'm useful to the world or not. Usefulness is also a very important theme of equity family, horses especially. They are extremely frustrated people. Whatever you do, they would tell you no one appreciates me. So lack of appreciation is what they feel. They struggle to do their duty. Like cow and other animals, they are also domesticated and abused, but not like cow. They feel forced to do something, beaten and exploited. Improving, we have seen that they felt unbearable pain, frustrated, just want to do nothing because everything is unbearable for them. Now we cannot bear. Irritable. They also feel failed, you know, failed to please or failed to perform or failed to do anything which with the task they have given up. So not up to the mark. That they always feel that, you know, I'm not performed up to the mark. They are very, very loyal, just like dogs. So they come close, little close to the dogs because in loyalty, they are actually almost similar. They are sociable and very affectionate people. So you can have a horse is a very, very good pet. Herd oriented. Sorry for the spelling mistakes, but they are herd oriented. Desire to please is there. So occasionally, they also don't resist back or fight back. They occasionally resist. Desire to please is there. They feel restricted. Freedom is there. The most important keyword which you will definitely get in the lac equinum. Sociable, they always like to party and like to go with the friends. Physically, they are very strong. Extraordinary skill and precision is there. Okay. Now we move towards the next remedy, which is sheep, which is lac ovis. So this is the meekest one, the meek and weak, no defense strategy, very timid, being dominated. So being dominated is one of the very important theme in lac ovis. Taken advantage. They always tell you that, you know, they are taking advantage of me. These people are exploiting me. I'm weak. I can't do anything. They are the meekest. So they easily go unnoticed. Okay. You don't notice them often. And they are totally defenseless. That's the basic difference between this remedy and, you know, the cow or buffalo. They are completely defenseless. But in cow and buffalo, you will see little defense or little irritation. In lac ovis, you don't see that. Crowded, gripped, overwhelmed, helplessness, resentment, cannot fight, doesn't have the voice. They always feel that they don't have the voice. These are the animals which are most used for the sacrifices. Small feeling, vulnerable, I need to be obedient, crushed, mutilated, and killed. This is a human expression of a feeling of, you know, sheep. Crushed, mutilated, and killed. Easily destroyed. They are very outgoing, adventurous, and they don't have good self-esteem. Sorry for this. Okay. So then, we'll talk about lion, which is the big cat, a predator. Only cat living in a group. So in felids, you will see all other cats, they are more solitary. But this cat, Lac Leo, they live in a group. Need for company is there. They love group and followers of them. They are charmingly bossy. They are very bossy, but charmingly, gracefully bossy. At times, they are very aggressive and good at getting work done, because they are extremely good leaders. So they would really encourage you to work. Lion is extremely competitive. Do not tolerate contradiction because they are the topmost predator. Just like the king of the jungle, they are also almost like a king or almost like a queen of the jungle. Do not tolerate contradiction. Powerful, but lazy. So they are quite lazy individuals. They would only hunt whenever they need food badly. Otherwise, they would just go and sleep. See, they love to throw parties as they love group and also attention. Protective. They have this feeling of, I should win. I must win. Hindered and also confident people. Okay. So now we go ahead towards a domestic small cat. The small cat, Lac Felinum. So in Lac Felinum or any cat, you will see a lot of autonomy, okay? Need for space or autonomic autonomous behavior, freedom, but freedom within the boundary of confinement. So freedom within the boundaries, within the confinement. Space is also very important for them. Cats allowed themselves for domestication so that, you know, they get the easy food. Otherwise, cats are the only, is the only animal which exercises its own rule in, even within the domestication also. You can't tie them. Independence within the boundaries or feeling of being small and dependent is still there. Freedom of choice. They are very rigid, highly ambitious people, and they like to clean a lot. So cleanliness is also one of the theme. I really like to give you some tips about using lac felinum, because I have used lac felinum many times, and I have very, you know, n number of cases of lac felinum. So they have very clear choices about everything, especially in children. Whenever I prescribe it to a children, I see that whether they are able to choose things or not. So they have clear choices, confident, they are highly sexual, appreciation is what they want. They kill by suffocation, you know, they catch or hold on to the throat, like I told you earlier also. Choosy, they're very, very choosy people, but clear preferences. And they are mostly loners. They don't have strong bonds, though they live in a group, but they don't have strong bonds with their family and friends. They're okay alone. High self-esteem. So I always prescribe this type of, this remedy to a patient who are self-dependent, decisive, little children who have, you know, clear choices, clear answers. And they don't, you know, just don't, not like Baraita, who always need parents. So they don't need parents to do everything. That's a great clue for prescribing lac felinum. They are not talkative, but not shy also. So they need their own space. Need of space, own space is very important issue for them. And often in athletes where the strong footwork is like, is there, I have prescribed this remedy often. And also to the artists, like dancers, especially, you know, the dances where the footwork is very important, just like Kathak and Bharatanatyam and like this. Or, you know, salsa or tango or something like that. Okay, so this is all about mammals and indications of some common like remedies which I have shared with you. I hope this has given you some clues about how to use this remedy. And now I would like to talk about one case in detail, so that, you know, you actually get that how to reach to a remedy. Okay, so we'll start a case, and at the end of the case I will take your questions. So this is a case of a 24 years male, last year or so I saw this case. So his chief complaint was acidity, heartburn and anxiety. And he says that from last 6 to 8 months, I'm feeling this. And he told me the brief background is that I did not go to the college. This is a 24 years old person who is telling me that he never went to a college. He started his own startup, like at the age of 19 years when he just graduated, not graduated, but he finished his schooling and he just went into a graduation. He took the admission into a college and then left it like this. So he said, you know, at the age of 19, I owned a startup and then I shifted to Hyderabad. He's basically from Nagpur. Then he shifted to Hyderabad. While joining, I was pretty sure that it was paying handsome, and so I joined because of the family responsibilities. So later you will get to know that his family was in a financial problem and crisis. So he's, you know, thought about starting a business. Later, I started feeling lonely. I feel helpless, don't know what to do. Then I am interested in stupid intellectual stuff. Minority group only understands it. He is telling me all these things that, you know, doctor, I am interested in few stupid intellectual things which everyone does not understand, and only minority group understands it. I find people very stupid to understand what I speak. So I don't talk to them. Only few people can understand my thoughts. And that's how, you know, I have a very little group. I talk to them. Otherwise, I stay calm. it's not that I'm superior and I have an ego problem, but it's a fact that they won't understand my thoughts and they are so mediocre and I am not. I had a relationship in Nagpur. So he was basically from Nagpur and he was into a relationship, but he left that relationship also. He left that girl because of some reason I left. I feel lonely, but I can't talk to someone. So I asked him, what do you feel when you say lonely? So he said, you know, whenever I feel lonely, I feel hollowness in my chest. There is nothing. It's completely hollow. And then he said, you know, there was no meaning in my work. I did not enjoy it. I couldn't find meaning in my work. I was not able to feel belonging to the work. Was not a part of it. I didn't find the space. I was finding out. So this feeling and anxiety started with work. This happens with me, that I do not find meaning in things and start detaching myself, or I just get bored of those things. So what happened to this guy is, at the age of 19, he initiated this startup. It went really well. And at one point of time, his investor told him something, and he thought that, you know, this whole startup I have made, and now this investor has come, and though he has invested money, he is telling me what to do and what not to do. So he just left the startup, and then he joined a job. Later he joined one job where he was getting a very, very handsome pay scale. His pay was really good, and with this job also he had started having some problem, and during this job only he came to me. So he told me that, you know, whenever I start losing the meaning of things, I start detaching myself and I get bored. So from 19 years to this 24 years, in last 5 years, he has done 3 startups and changed 2 jobs. So then I asked more about, I had to push myself for doing all this stuff, and his sleep was also disturbed. Numbness was there. Could not feel happy, could not feel sad. So basically he was neutral, not interested in anything, lot of lack of energy. And metaphorically he said, there is one shell which I cannot break. So I'm in the shell. No energy and passion. What is bothering you the most was my question. So when there was, you know, can you see there is a lot of complexity in his narration also. He said, you know, I left the job, this happened to me, I get bored, and then there is a shell, and a lot of things are coming up. So then I asked, what is bothering you the most? Whenever you put this question, my meaning is to get that thing which is the most important priority for the patient. Okay. So he said, you know, I'm not able to find the meaning, energy, which I had earlier. You know, suddenly it is absent. And I have this guilt. And he also talked about this snowball effect. He told me, you know, whenever there is from the top of the mountain, the snow falls down and it comes down, and there is more snow added to the ball, and it becomes bigger and bigger and bigger. And similarly, in my life also, I have started losing the meaning of my job, meaning of things doing, and it is getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And now I'm getting anxious. So I don't find people around me who can understand the stuff which I'm going through. So that also bothers him, that people are not able to understand. He's not able to convey his emotions or his feelings. But here also you will see that there is a communication problem. So initially, like I told you, communication is very important for mammals. He told me, I have 2 personalities inside me. One is logical and other is completely irrational, completely illogical. So this is a dilemma. Like I will tell you, when I started working at 19 years of age, I convinced this investor, and he has invested 6 crores in my startup. So when actually he started doing, you know, things on business, first investor of his, got ready to invest 6 crore rupees. This is a huge amount. I was so surprised when I was hearing to him, because he is just 24 years and still he left that startup. So he told me that I was happy working and it was all logical and rational according to society. You know, my needs were taken care of. Everything was happening. And then the second personality in me came up. I should not have left the job. you know, also that startup, but I did that. The second person is completely insane, not logical. So then I didn't get right feeling. So, you know, I just felt that this is not going right. And I just felt that something wrong is happening. So I left it. I find myself more artist than a businessman. If I stop earning completely, my family will go, you know, badly hit by the financial crisis. So everything will be stopped. So I don't want to do that, but still I have left the job. Father's business is not good. So my decision impacts their life. Also somewhere I need to satisfy them. So in his life, the family is also very, very important because he did everything for the family. So he told me in starting, I was mad. Firmly, I had this feeling that if I'm not getting value education, why should I continue? So I left the college. I was more focused on my growth, but later I did job because I had to look after the family's responsibility. So then I feel there should be a plan B. So I burned that whole option. You know, he felt that there shouldn't be a plan B. So he just, you know, he just left the college in first year only. And he thought that I shouldn't feel this to coming back to the college. I'm not getting value education. And he started his business, the small business. He did in 10th class only. Then he said that my dilemma is inside we all have inner compass which tells you the right direction or the right thing for you. But now in my case, I'm completely confused. And earlier situation was not that frightening for me, but now I'm very anxious. So he's actually suffering from existential crisis now. Then I asked about his work and then he said, you know, my friends of organic clothing, the store was based in US. And I thought it was stable. Then we started second company. And then in the second project, a lot of legal problems happened. So he left the first one, then the second one. Then he went to the Hyderabad for online software business. And then he said, that, you know, I don't know about this, but I understand inner psychology and philosophy so well. I have a lot of interest in learning people's behavior, understanding. So I found that my colleagues and partners have different interests than me. It was weird. So I left them. And also I feel that I offend people very easily. I'm very straightforward. In Hyderabad, I couldn't talk to people. I was very reserved. I don't find any meaning in deep relationship. I hate small dogs. I used to hate time pass and they used to love it. And now I'm thinking to quit this job. So this company which I'm working with is an online software company right now, which he's working with. I was working as a freelancer for them. Because I have a lot of responsibilities, but slowly my focus is getting lost. I always do productive work, not like 9 to 5. People used to mock at me because my interests were different. I fought with people. And when I asked about his experience, when he told that people used to mock at him, he told me that it feels rejected, secluded, and not so important. And I always feel that though I'm in a group, I'm alone in the group. Because we had this financial crisis, I had the inferiority complex also. So, you know, you can see all the traits, inferiority, superiority, small, big, group, rejected, you know, mocking, bullying. This is all coming up. So his father was a defaulter. He had taken a lot of loans and he could not repay. So he was also not able to go into a good school because of the financial issues of the family. Until actually, he said that people told me that I'm different, I'm intelligent. So now I had something which is different. So I felt, you know, nice that, you know, okay, I'm superior. I have this intelligence. Social hierarchy. Just a minute. Yeah. So he said, you know, I can't bear fakeness, fake people. I'm a racist in a way. When actually he shifted to Hyderabad, so he did not, you know, like Telugu people somehow. He felt that they were dominating, and he said, you know, in a way I'm very racist and in a way I'm not. So I'm racist in a way that I couldn't connect to the Telugu people. I felt that they were dominating, and though in philosophy or politics I am like socialist, communist theory, but everyone is equal there. I like that. I don't want to work under anyone because that is creatively restricting for me. I don't like structure, pattern. I have this rebellious nature. So I asked him, what do you feel when you see structure? And he said, you know, I'm very competitive. My father used to bring these chocolates and I used to feel that these many chocolates he has got for me, or these many chocolates he is giving to someone else. In company also, I used to feel that, you know, they are not valuing me, they are giving importance to someone else. So in that way, I'm very, very competitive. This is my basic nature. I'm very ambitious. So you see, the mammal themes are emerging, the ambitiousness, the competition and everything. Then he approached a girl and he said, you know, I was health scared and I feel very, very inferior. Culturally also, that lot of change I felt in Hyderabad. I was in Nagpur and I was a weird guy. And he told me about his childhood that, you know, I had a big head in childhood and I used to cry a lot. And the maths teacher used to punish me a lot. And in social studies, I was good, but I used to feel a lot of rejection, you know. And he used to feel about his body. He felt that his face and chest was shallow. I felt like crying in the moment of rejection. I like self-sympathy. I mean, used to pity myself that I had a big head and, you know, things like that. And then he told me a story about his childhood where there were two grounds in his school. One was a big ground and one was a small ground. And these big boys did not allow him to, you know, get involved in the big ground. And there was a birthday of a guy and he was, you know, bullied by people and things like that. So I asked him, what was your feeling? And he said, you know, I felt really lonely. Within the group, I was lonely. And I felt a pain inside me. I just wanted to cry out. It was more of an irritating inside. You know, it was like a small puppy whose mother is not there. He's lonely, nowhere to go, no place which he can call home, no people, no language to communicate. I just felt like that puppy. So by nature, he's a very reserved guy. He feels heavy. I want to go somewhere alone and stay there. Solitude is one thing which he really likes. Physically, you know, he likes to meditate also. Physically, he feels shallow. I see people, I choose them, I see their philosophy out of structure, body experience. So he said, you know, I always see that whether people are able to see beyond body or not. And that is important for me. So, you know, a lot of meditation and spirituality and ethics and all these things he spoke about. And then he told me that he likes chocolate and coffee and sweets and tangy, spicy things. He also had all the past history I had, but that is not very important. But he had in childhood jaundice and tonsillectomy and like this. So the basic theme of his case was, he told me that it's very important for me that are people approving of me is very important. So he is in a relationship now. So current relationship which I am into, it started because everyone had one girlfriend. I wanted one. So it's almost like copying others. I see females of my age and I become very, very conscious. And some part of me wants approval of women. I'm confused about the whole relationship. I feel like, you know, I don't feel like talking. Main feeling is of rejected and lonely and not trusted and like this. So in this whole expression also, you can see that he needs approval from women or from anyone. And, you know, he feels dirty about himself, not good about himself, his body, and he feels that his head is very big. And what he likes is he likes meditation. He has immense interest in spirituality. And so in all these years, I had this confusion in mind because I have worked extremely hard for my family, or you can say to get that approval of the people. I have tried very, very hard. So I should live with my own space, my things, my meditation. And then this second thought comes to me that whether I should live for them or myself. This is an ongoing dilemma, ongoing process. Finance is very important for him. He feels pity for, you know, puppies, helpless people. And one thing which I have observed during the whole case was he was talking with his intellect. He was very, very intellectual. Okay. And then he told me, you know, I really like panda movies, watching pandas. And then I explored pandas a little bit. And he said, you know, playfulness is very important for me. I like to play. And playful, being playful or liking to play is very important theme of mammals. Okay. So then he told me something about the culture of exploitation and, you know, the socialism and communism and things like that. And he told about that in the culture of exploitation, one cannot attain its full potential. And it is same in the MNC. So the MNCs, what happens is they exploit yourself so that you cannot attain your full potential and you are not getting your due position. Okay. So this was about the case. Can anyone suggest me any remedy? No, so okay. So I have prescribed him lacumanum. So lacumanum I have not spoken about, not talked about in my whole presentation because I just wanted to, you know, convey this that lacumanum people, they are extremely good people and they have this constant dilemma of being selfish or being selfless. So this person, what he is doing is he was actually working for family, you know, getting approval, and he was very concerned about what people are thinking, what people are talking, what his family is saying. He was intelligent, but at the same time his dilemma was whether I should do for myself or whether I should do for, you know, family. And that's how he talked about socialism and communism, because it, you know, it is a dilemma between there are two type of mentalities. One is socialism. So in socialism, what happens, or communism, what happens, everything belongs to, every resource belongs to community. And in commercial world, like the world which we are living in here, what happens is, you know, you are very selfish. Everything belongs to you. You just want to own every resource. Okay. So in follow-ups, what happened that in first follow-up, he felt much better. His thoughts were very clear. He was able to focus. He had the sleeplessness and acidity. So no acidity at all. And I just prescribed 1 mg. And in the first follow-up, I did not give anything. I gave SL. And then for 6 months, he did not see me. And it's after 6 months, he came to me and he said, I'm having little acidity. And again, I'm not able to focus on anything. I again gave lacumanum 1 mg dose. And 4th July, recently, I took a follow-up and it was much better. No acidity, no heartburn, nothing at all. Focus is also much better. He's still in a dilemma, but that is quite reduced. So he felt a lot of relief after lacumanum. So important themes of lacumanum is they are very intelligent, competitive, very spiritual people. Important stuff they want to do. They don't want to do, you know, the common job. Like he said, no, I just want to do meaningful things. And they feel a lot of loneliness, empty feeling, like the shallow feeling, which is described in the chest. Two wills. So whether I need to do for my family or whether I have to, you know, practice my meditation, my business and things like that. Hierarchy, so bullied in school, equalism, just like communism, two wills, very concerned about the family. And because it was a delusion or emotion driven case, I gave 1 mg. Also talks about the minority and majority, ooch neech, the caste system. He also talked about, you know, the Nagpur people and the Telugu people and domination or being dominated, the white, black, the capitalism and the communism, the story of exploitation, average versus superior, society versus alone, playfulness. So these are the lacumanum themes, the equalism, the two wills. The two wills are very, very important. Very concerned about family and closed ones, and they're very caring and loving people. Benevolence is very important thing. You know, bullying, when a person takes advantage of a weaker person, you know, just like ragging, bullying. Two wills, am I doing what is right or am I doing wrong? I should have made plan B, but I haven't. So this was his constant dilemma that, you know, I burned my plan B, but now I feel I should have made this. Intelligence. In corporate situation, you will see a lot of, you know, exploitation. So this is the main theme of lack humanum, being highly spiritual and God-fearing against bouts of being unreligious and sinful. Obsessed about individuality versus group conformity. So Dr. Shankaran has proved this remedy, and this is a very nicely well-proved remedy and very, very important remedy for these days where there is forsaken, alone feeling is there, two wills is there, sadness is there. Yeah. So these are all the cravings, the cold drinks, the milk desire for the tea aggravates, the tea desires. So as the can said, that all the milks should be potentized. They are the most excellent remedies. They are animal products and foods of early animal life and therefore correspond to innermost physical nature. So we should have proved actually all the milks available. So that is all what I wanted to convey. If you have any questions or queries, please let me know.
Okay. Dear participants, you can have any doubts, you can please put it in the chat box. I think we are done around 2 hours, I think.
Yes.
Please, Yamini ma'am, can you just start your camera?
Yeah.
You can see the chat box, or I should read.
Yeah, I will see. So, lac felinum is a cat, domestic cat. Okay. So, someone is asking a difference between lion and tiger and leopard is a lengthy thing. But of course, the lion tiger will have a lot of high self-esteem, and a leopard has a lot of cunningness with it, along with the planning and everything. Which books to read? So I would recommend Sensation by Dr. Rajan Shankaran, in which he has explained the animal themes and mammals also. Along with that, for mammals, you need to read Dr. Bhavesha and Sachindra Joshi's book Mammals. I just want to share this. I have in my, this is a book. You can get this book.
And also, I have a request to all the delegates. See, these people all are coming from then their courses in the academy. So rather than look for this, these sessions are all not only for this inspiration like that. You should follow that. When you are apply, when will you you will get the experience when you apply it in your practice. So you need to go to the courses rather than asking this, what is this lack felinum is about, like this kind of childish questions, please avoid, okay? If you wanted to know anything, if you have doubts regarding any topic which she covered, please ask that, okay?
Okay, so Dr. Biswas, you're asking medicine from milk of a tiger. So we don't have a medicine from milk of a tiger. We couldn't, get that because of the power and everything. So we have a tiger's blood and tiger's urine. Panthera tigris and one more. I don't remember the name, but the tiger's urine is, the medicine name is tiger's urine. Which pharmacy shall we get in Mumbai? So a lot of pharmacies make these remedies. If you need remedies, you can also contact us. But there are many companies, I would like to tell you, that the common lac remedies you will get in Shobe, SPL, and St. George is a very good company. It's from South only. And they have a good number of lac remedies. And there are many, many pharmacies. So I procure my remedies from many pharmacies. And thank you so much for your feedback. So lack humanum I have from Remedia and Answer.
Anjali, do you want to ask anything? You can unmute yourself, okay? constantly raising the hand actually. I have sent you the request. Can you just unmute yourself? Okay, okay. I think she can't do that. Okay, you can take up the questions.
Okay. Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, there were the patient which came to you, he was having something like two personalities, you said, like one, like inner personality was hidden. So even that is a strong symptom, then why not anacardium?
Yeah, so anacardium doesn't have two personalities. Anacardium has two wills, you know. On one shoulder, there is a symptom, no, in anacardium, that on one shoulder, the devils tell the person that, you know, you have to do this wrong. And on one shoulder, there is, you know, the second force or second spirit, which is telling him, you know, you have to do this. So, of course, this two wills and dilemma is there in anacardium also. But if you want to prescribe anacardium, then you should have the whole genius or the central theme of that plant family, which is Anacardiaceae. And the main theme of Anacardiaceae is caught and stuck and stiff. And okay, this constant dilemma is not there. It is not constant dilemma. It is only one of the symptom of Anacardium.
Okay, okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Welcome. So, I hope I was able to convey the gist of mammals.
Praveen, are you there? Dr. Praveen?
Yes, Deepu.
No. So, I think we can continue the session.
Okay, okay. Thank you, ma'am. It was a wonderful session. Lots and lots of information about mammals group. And only few mammals we were using in our practice, and this is such a lot of mammals that we are yet to be knowing. And thank you for such a good session. It is so long till now, and on behalf of state chapter, I extend my hearty thanks for coming for this session, and thank you all the participants. Once again, thank you. Thanks a lot, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I also want to express my heartfelt gratitude to each and every member of IHMS, especially Dr. Deepu, and all the members and all the participants who have listened patiently. I am also a learner, so I'm also in the learning process. You might feel that you have not understood. If you have not understood anything or you have any questions, I will definitely try to answer them. You can write to me on rjyamini@gmail.com. You can just email me. Thank you so much. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, ma'am.